Hello, welcome to the third of the Huddersfield Local History Society's 2020-2021 season of online talks. I'm delighted to introduce today's speaker, Dr. Christine Verguson. Members will know her best as a long-standing member of the Society, as a long-serving committee member, as publicity officer, and as the first author, if you like, and compiler of her newsletter. Many may even remember her when she worked in Huddersfield Local History and Archives. But what's far less well known is the time she spent working for the BBC as a researcher and journalist, or the research she did on the BBC Regional Broadcasting, which led to her PhD. More recently, she's been working with Huddersfield's premier amateur dramatic society, the Thespians, whose centenary is this year. Sadly, like so much else, a proper celebration of the centenary has fallen victim to the pandemic, although I understand a book is planned for 2021. Today, under the intriguing title, People Who Talk Edgerton, James R Gregson and Huddersfield Thespian Society, she'll be exploring a particular chapter in the Society's long history and the way it responded to a comment made in 1927 by James R Gregson, suggesting that the Thespians had lost their way. Who, you might ask, was he to say that? Well, Gregson was a very interesting character. In fact, on a previous season, I think we've had a talk about him on the occasion of a biography being published. But he was an interesting character, and much later, a nationally well-known one. He was born in Brighouse, a politically radical man of the left, a conscientious objector in the First World War, a playwright, an actor, a theatre manager, and in the 1930s and 1940s, a BBC radio personality. But in 1920-21, he had been one of the Thespians' founder members. His quip about the Thespians being people who talk Edgerton is a wry comment on the Thespians' place in Huddersfield society between the wars and how they responded to his suggestion that they had lost their way in 1927. Can't help but reflect that. How they responded in detail is another matter. Christy.
Hello. The Huddersfield Thespians were founded in 1920, and for the last couple of years, I've been researching their history and exploring their vast archive in order to compile a book to mark the Amateur Dramatic Society's centenary. It is hoped that the book will both extend and bring up to date founder member Sidney Crowther's Golden Jubilee history published in 1970. But in this short talk, I want to look at only one aspect of the Thespians' long history, the Society's relationship with the dramatist James Gregson. Gregson, like Crowther, was a founder member of the Society. And while Gregson said of Crowther, the idea was his, the first moves were his, Crowther said much the same about Gregson. I should also say that most of the images used in this presentation are taken from the Thespians' own archive, and particularly from their cuttings books. When in 1927 Gregson accused the Thespians of attracting people talking Edgerton to their shows, what did he mean? For those who don't live in Huddersfield, Edgerton is an area to the northwest of the town centre, comprised mainly of large Victorian houses and once home to merchants and manufacturers. It is, I think, safe to assume that Gregson was referring not so much to geography as to social class. In the course of bringing the Thespians' history up to date, I have interviewed people who are still active in the society, and long-standing members have told me that before the Second World War, the Thespians drew their membership from the quality of the town. In the course of this talk, while touching on the society's social composition during these years, I will focus on Gregson's relationship with the Huddersfield Thespians and suggest that perhaps they did provide Huddersfield playgoers with more ambitious productions than they were likely to experience on the professional stage. To illustrate this, I would first like to take you back to Monday, the 25th of June, 1925, and ask you to imagine you are having a night out at Huddersfield's Theatre Royal. You may be there because you like to go to the theatre every week or when you can afford it, but it is also possible that you've come along to see the much talked about, relatively new play that is on tonight, performed by the Huddersfield Thespians. Arriving at the theatre, at some point you would have been given a flyer, which was not an advert for a forthcoming production, but a notice to robots, written by robots, at a time when Daleks and Cybermen had yet to be imagined. But these robots were just as unfriendly. "We command you to kill all mankind. Spare no man, spare no woman." The play was Carol Chapek's R.U.R., and a programme note explained that robot was a new word, added to the English language by this play. And if this was not enough, the programme stated that the thespians would be following it with The Adding Machine, an expressionist play by the American Elmer Rice, which the note's author claimed was unlike any play yet produced in this or any other country. Some of you may have heard a talk given to Huddersfield Local History Society by Barry Smith, to whom we owe a great debt of gratitude for publishing, editing and annotating Gregson's autobiography, which had previously only existed in typescript form. However, Gregson was a busy man, and there aren't that many references to the thespians in his autobiography. James Gregson and Sidney Crowther first met when Gregson took up the post of front of house manager at the Theatre Royal. Crowther, the Examiner's drama critic, remembered greeting Gregson with the words, "So this is the Yorkshire Ibsen." Or so the theatre's manager, Alfred Waring, had told him. Waring's ambitions for the theatre extended far beyond just getting bums on seats. He established a repertory season which ran from 1921 to 1931, and he had ambitions of bringing European theatre to Huddersfield, particularly the work of Pirandello. He was exactly the sort of theatre manager that might be prepared to encourage a new and ambitious theatre company. According to Crowther, it was in the manager's office at the Theatre Royal that the thespians began. Sidney Crowther was just 24 years of age. At this point, seems to have been still living in the family home, supporting his widowed mother. James Gregson had been born in Brickhouse in 1889, but his job as a clerk of the Lancashire and Yorkshire Railway had taken him to Manchester. Not only had he married and started a family, but he also had two full-length comedies performed by the time he moved to Huddersfield in 1919. As Gregson told the Craven Herald in 1962, "The idea was that I should learn all about the stage and theatre, and I certainly had plenty of scope. I can truthfully say I have done every job in theatre except looked after the ladies' cloakroom." While in Manchester, Gregson and his wife Florence had a close association with the Stockport Garrick Theatre, thought to be the first amateur group to stage Shaw and Ibsen. It also produced Gregson's first play and was to provide a model for Huddersfield's new dramatic society. Sidney Crowther introduced Gregson to his old headmaster at Hill House Higher Elementary School, Robert Montgomery. Members of the Old Boys Union would gather at Montgomery's house on Sunday evenings to discuss all the problems of the universe. But the Old Boys also had their own dramatic society, and Gregson had a new comedy ready for production. Despite the programme's promise that this would be the first and last performance of this play on any stage, the latest production I've been able to trace was by the Homebridge Amateur Operatic and Dramatic Society in 1950. Nevertheless, at the post-production discussion in Montgomery's house, it was decided to form a new dramatic society. For some reason, the Huddersfield Daily Examiner, reporting that a new local dramatic society was to be formed in the town, thought that the venture was unorthodox. At the preliminary meeting held at Broadbent's canteen, Mr. Gregson moved the motion, seconded by Mr. Holliday, that a play-producing society be formed in Huddersfield. Gregson later reflected, "We called ourselves the Huddersfield Thespians, made Montgomery our first president, and became, by a short head, the earliest amateur experimental group in Yorkshire." Note the word experimental. In addition to Philip Robinson and F.A. Bean from the Old Boys, others who already had experience of putting on plays were invited to join the new venture. These included the Reverend Leonard Hines from Fitzwilliam Street Unitarian Church and Andrea Woolner, art mistress at Greenhead High School. Alfred Waring, the manager of the Theatre Royal, also gave the project his full support, bringing from Huddersfield Amateur Operatic Society, H.C. Calvert of Calvert & Co. Engineers, and Major Ernest Hurst, a Royal Agent, who had commanded the Duke of Wellington's 2nd Volunteer Battalion during the First World War. And as the minutes of the first general meeting show, they were all voted onto a general committee, which also included Mary Sykes, Huddersfield's first woman solicitor, who would go on to become a Labour councillor, Huddersfield's first woman alderman, and first woman mayor. She was appointed honorary solicitor to the society, but also acted in the early years. Edith Spikes taught music at Greenhead. F.A. Carter, a director of the Carter Edge Tool Company in Kirkburton, had published a collection of poetry and prose in 1916 while serving with the Duke of Wellington's, and was already writing dialect plays. Elliot Dalt was the leader writer, later editor of the Examiner, and while Hilda Chilton did not get elected to the first general committee, she would go on to get many of the best parts. Gregson did not stand for election, but took on various roles, including secretary and librarian in the first few years. However, the minutes of this first meeting show that there were already differences of opinion within the society. The meeting decided unanimously, but only after an hour or two's discussion, that Gregson's proposal for a performance to raise funds for the Labour-supporting Daily Herald should not be associated with the Thespians. The first thespian production was an open-air performance in Greenhead Park of Henry Fielding's one-act adaptation of Molière's The Mock Doctor for the annual Huddersfield Carnival in June. But today, the thespians recognise the Don, performed at the Temperance Hall on the 13th of October 1920 as their first show. While Sidney Crowther described these as trial and error performances, Huddersfield socialist newspaper The Worker hated the Don as a play, but bestowed praise on every performer with a special plaudit for producer Robert Montgomery. Both F.A. Carter and Gregson contributed one-act plays to the first season, but according to Sidney Crowther, the productions established the thespians' reputation was the more mainstream Quality Street, performed at the Theatre Royal in December 1920. The programme also included an ambitious mission statement. The Society aimed to establish a school of Yorkshire drama, as well as its own little theatre, which ideally would show a production every week. And while a play by Barry might seem to be a safe option, this certainly wasn't true of the next show, Mrs. Warren's Profession, billed as an unpleasant play by George Bernard Shaw, and at the time still banned by the Lord Chamberlain because of its portrayal of prostitution. It was possible, though, to give private performances of banned plays, which meant that anyone wanting to see the production had to be a member of the Society. Both Gregson and Carter wrote dialect plays, and I think the Society aimed to provide a home for Yorkshire dialect drama. This is not explored in this talk, and as a comer in, it's not something I feel qualified to comment on. I think, though, it was hoped the Society would encourage local playwrights, whether or not they wrote in dialect. I should also say that while thespian productions normally took place in the Temperance Hall, and thanks to Waring, occasionally at the Theatre Royal, in their early years the company also took productions out to halls across the district. The thespians probably came closest to Gregson's idea of an experimental amateur group in 1925, with the two plays mentioned at the beginning of this talk, R.U.R. and The Adding Machine, although in September 1923, an announcement in the press of the plays to be performed in the coming season, including The Machine Wreckers, described as a drama of the English Luddites by German expressionist Ernst Toller, although for some reason this was replaced by Hobson's Choice. The thespians had originally performed R.U.R. at the Temperance Hall, where it played to packed houses, the Leeds Mercury praising the remarkably good performance of what their critic described as a weird play. The Adding Machine proved to be much more controversial. It says something about the thespians, or possibly Gregson's gift for publicity, that the Leeds Mercury declared the Huddersfield production to be the first in the UK, despite having reported on the York Everyman Theatre's production earlier in the year. In both productions, Gregson played the lead role of Mr. Zero, co-producing in York and producing in Huddersfield, where the newspaper observed there were times when the audience did not know whether to laugh or to be horrified. Both audiences and critics were divided over the play, with even the Society's own annual report stating that its judgment in producing this play had been both praised and condemned. And, as the slide suggests, it also sparked off a debate in The Examiner between two regular columnists, with Simplex in the pulpit from Pewcom accusing the play of showing accelerated decadence and morbid sexuality. Playfellow had not seen the production, but claimed to know the play well. Not only was he more generous, but he also gave some idea of the play's contents. Mr. Zero, a clerk played by Gregson, is described as a symbol of the thousands of white-collar slaves with machine-made minds and thwarted desires. When Zero asks for a pay rise, he is told he is being replaced by a vending machine. As well as Gregson, Thespians Philip Robinson and F.A. Bean wrote letters to the newspaper in response to Simplex's attack. As it was even before this, the choice of plays did not please every thespian. In March 1924, Irving Fisher, claiming that he was also speaking for other members, told the Society's General Committee that he disapproved of the choice of plays then being considered, and that more worthy and more popular work should be chosen. But he was unable to make any suggestions of his own. The committee accepted his resignation, but Fisher must have overcome his differences with the Society, because between 1926 and his death in 1930, he received several good notices, and 1925's challenging plays were followed by a run of comedies. The Thespians saw their next and sixth season as the most remarkable since their foundation, marking in their annual report that never before have the activities of the Society been so widespread, the support given to us by the public has never been so good. Certainly, one of the most important landmarks in the Thespians' history was to send a team to New York to take part in the Belasco Cup for amateur theatre groups producing one-act plays. For the first time in 1926, the British Drama League was invited to compete, and in order to select its entry, the league held its first national competition for one-act plays. Seven amateur societies entered, with the Huddersfield Thespians submitting two plays, James Gregson's Liddy and Frank Sladen Smith's St. Simeon Stylites. Sladen Smith's plays were widely produced for amateur societies in the 1920s, and his play came first in the British competition, with Gregson's Liddy in fourth place. In addition to H.C. Calvert in the title role, the cast members bound for New York included Harold Hallis, Hilda Chilton, Doll Davison, Hildred Taylor, Philip Robinson and George Beaumont. Hallis, who was well known in Huddersfield as a singer, produced. Here they are, setting off from the railway station and enjoying life on board the RMS Carpania. While the Thespian party was sightseeing in New York prior to the competition, Huddersfield found itself caught up in the general strike. On the first day of the strike, the Examiner, reduced to two sides of typescript, still found space for Hilda Chilton's cable. Reception exceeded all expectation. Herald and Self broadcasting tonight. Entertained hotel, delighted with invitations. All well and hopeful. The play depicts a bad-natured saint sitting on top of a column in the desert, where he is visited via ladder by the world in the shape of a king, the flesh, a painted woman, a pilgrim, the devil, and others who all fail to tempt him down. He explains that he remains there not out of faith, but from habit. In the event, the Belasco Cup went to the Dallas Little Theatre, with the Thespians being judged the runners-up, as well as receiving favourable reviews. More than one critic remarked that Calvert gave the best individual performance of the competition, while the Daily News reviewer declared that Hilda Chilton was as fair an actress lady and as well-spoken as any who had visited this town in months and months, either professional or amateur. Praise indeed. James Gregson had left the Society during the 1925-26 season. By then, he was already an honorary member. But in 1927, perhaps not entirely seriously, he told the Manchester Players Society, "What the Huddersfield players badly want now is a severe failure. They have become awfully fashionable. We get a lot of people who talk Edgerton, and about a dozen cars wait outside the show for our patrons now." And while this might seem like a critique of the audience the Thespians were attracting rather than the producers and players, Gregson also suggested that they had got into a rut. In reply, the thespians, who were said to be, for the most part, mildly amused, pointed to the variety of plays that the Society produced, some of which they had claimed would otherwise not have been seen in Yorkshire. 2 years later, he again called the thespians to task, but also other amateur theatre groups, when he claimed that the little theatre movement in Yorkshire had not yet justified its existence, nor was he hopeful that it ever would. Performances in Huddersfield, Sheffield and Leeds were sometimes worse than they had been in the early days of the movement, with too little attention being paid to acting technique. Set design was generally disappointing, and lighting neglected. In addition, no outstanding producer or playwright has been discovered. He accused the thespians of abandoning their original intention to produce their experimental theatre. But in the following year, he was praising the same amateurs for keeping drama pure. The thespians continued to perform Gregson's plays, and when he, his wife Florence, and thespian Marion Rhodes accompanied a party of Castleford schoolchildren to Germany in August 1928, the Yorkshire Post headline read, "Young players tour with Huddersfield thespian members in Germany." So, had the thespian lost their direction, or perhaps their direction as defined by Gregson? This slide shows one of the thespian's most treasured documents, a letter from D.H. Lawrence giving the Society permission to perform his biblical play David, and even promising to come and see it if he was in the country. In the end, the thespians didn't do the play. It was produced only once during Lawrence's lifetime in London in May 1927, where it had received mixed reviews because of time, two scenes had to be omitted, and more than one commentator seemed to think that was for the best. The letter from Lawrence is dated November, so it is likely that the thespians were already aware of how the play had been received when they approached Lawrence. But perhaps the biggest indicator of the thespians' ambition was their production of James Lonsdale Hodgson's Red Knight. Hodgson, a Lancashire journalist, was already a well-known novelist and broadcaster when in April 1930 he entrusted the thespians with the world premiere of Red Knight, a play based on his most successful novel, Grey Dawn, Red Knight. Although Hodgson's success as a journalist meant he was already working in London, he was happy to attend a rehearsal of the thespians' headquarters, which was then at Waverley House. Hodgson is reported to have told the cast and producer, E. Newman Chilton, "You are a plucky lot to attempt this play at all." That Hodgson stayed with the Gregsons during his visit suggests a prior acquaintance, and this may be why the thespians were given the opportunity to premiere his play. The Huddersfield Daily Examiner noted that while R.C. Sheriff's Journey's End, first performed in London in December 1928, had a public school atmosphere, Red Knight was the rancorous war play. The play explores the themes of war weariness and disillusion and depicts the breakdown of its central character, Private Hardcastle, played by Frank Cornby. The play, performed at the Temperance Hall, was widely reviewed, and the production, performances and settings were generally very well received. However, the same could not be said of the writing, with most commentators suggesting that the first acts of the play required dramatic editing, noting that it lasted for more than 3.5 hours. But both the thespians and the playwright rose to the challenge, with Hodgson rewriting the first act. The Leeds Mercury's editor came to Huddersfield to see the play and was happy to report that the problems encountered on the first night had been put right. He particularly praised the intelligence with which the Huddersfield thespians approached all their work and congratulated them on their production, and also the author for having found in this industrial town so much talent and sincerity to set forth his little world of living the life of the doomed. The play was revived in London in 2005, but there is no mention in the programme of the part the Huddersfield thespians played in its genesis. But who were the pre-war thespians? Certainly, if their addresses were anything to go by, then it may have been that some leading thespians did indeed speak Edgerton. There were certainly several wool merchants and wool agents amongst their number. The thespians' most prolific producer before the war, E. Newman Chilton, was a wholesale clothier. In addition to some of the founding members mentioned earlier, Hildred Taylor was a cigar manufacturer, and Irving Fisher, who had objected to the choice of plays, was a sales representative for a Manchester making up and packing firm. Frank R. Cornby, managing director of a company that made card boxes, was a Conservative councillor for Paddock Ward between 1930 and 1933. Harold Hallis worked for a time as an architect for Huddersfield Corporation, later joining his family's leather manufacturing firm. When travelling to New York for the Belasco Cup, Harold, a noted baritone, described himself as a vocalist, and several thespians were active in the town's leading music societies. However, two names associated with thespians would have been particularly familiar to Huddersfield people. Caterer and confectioner Frederick Whiteley acted and served on the Society's committee, and social events were frequently held in Whiteley's well-known cafe, Westgate. Just down the road from Whiteley's was Rushworth's store, which in 1925 boasted of having 25 different departments. Managing Director George E. Rushworth served as the Thespian Secretary from 1929, and on retiring from that post, just a few months before he died, he was elected as a Vice President of the Society. His nephew Dennis was also a key member of the Thespians. Dennis and his wife Dora both acted and produced. Engineer Horace Broadbent, who had made his firm's work canteen available for the Thespians' first meeting, continued to support the Society until his death in 1942. The Harry Potter star and Oscar-winning actor Jim Broadbent is Horace's grandson. But it would be wrong to think that the Thespians only took their members from the town's elite. Solicitors, teachers, architects and journalists were amongst those who trod the Thespians' boards. Sidney Crowther was himself a journalist, and journalism was one of Gregson's sources of income. Philip Robinson had worked as a chemist in an industrial laboratory. Donald Davison was an automobile engineer, and F.A. Bean was a railway's goods clerk. George Beaumont had been a clerk and a dental mechanic, but was also a gifted set designer, representing the Society at an exhibition of community theatre art in August 1925. He later worked for a time as a theatrical scenic designer in Harrogate, but he was back with the Thespians from the mid-1930s, designing sets that were frequently praised by the press. The Yorkshire Post drama correspondent, praising the Thespians in November 1938, asserted that they drew their actors and actresses not infrequently from the factories in and around the town. Yet the extent to which this was the case is unclear. Following a rush of applications for membership from women in 1926, the committee took the decision to suspend their admission for a time to give existing members the chance to appear on stage. 2 years later, they were complaining about a shortage of young male actors. Even before Gregson formally resigned from the Thespians, he was providing acting tuition at the Leeds Industrial Theatre and was involved in the Leeds Civic Theatre from its beginning. Writing his autobiography, he says of his three seasons at the Leeds Civic, "Besides holding down my factory job and running a theatre, I was writing at full pressure and always against the clock. In addition to turning out several newspaper serials, each running to 70 or 80,000 words, I had a weekly column in the Leeds Mercury, did some book reviewing, and articles were here and there, and on top of all of that, found time during 1926 to write my most successful play, The Devil a Saint." In 1931, Gregson formed his own touring company, the Yorkshire Players. Both Philip Robinson and George Beaumont gave up their day jobs to join his company. Having run out of money, Gregson was soon back living in Huddersfield, and in 1935 he was elected to the Borough Council as a Labour representative. Philip Robinson went to Bradford Civic Playhouse, eventually becoming its director. And it is clear that even outside the Thespians, Gregson was frequently happy to cast people who spoke Edgerton in his plays. In April 1926, sound broadcasting was still relatively new when the Yorkshire Evening News told its readers that this was their chance to hear the famous Huddersfield Thespians broadcasting live from the BBC's Leeds Bradford station in Basinghall Street, Leeds. The play was the Thespians' Belasco Cup entry, as it was felt that the broadcast fee would help towards the cost of the New York trip. The amateur actors were faced with the challenge of adapting their stage production to the realities of a radio studio, where voice projection was discouraged and there was no audience present to react to the performance. James Gregson had given his first radio talk in 1924, and he was soon also producing radio plays for the BBC in Leeds. Devil a Saint, for example, was performed in the BBC Leeds studio between a matinee and an evening performance at Leeds Civic Playhouse. By 1932, he had put together his own group of broadcasting actors, which he called the Yorkshire Radio Players. Thespians George Beaumont, Philip Robinson and F.A. Bean appeared regularly with the company. In 1933, the BBC opened new premises in Woodhouse Lane, Leeds, which were described at the time as the most modern in the country. Certainly the main studio was bigger than anything that could be found at the BBC in Manchester. Wilfred Pickles later recalled that when he went over to Leeds before the Second World War, it was either to work as an announcer or to take part in one of Gregson's plays. And thespians often appeared in radio productions that had nothing to do with Gregson. Both George Beaumont and Frank Quarmby took part in broadcasts by the Yorkshire Mummers, who described themselves as providing light entertainment, especially by the microphone, to show the rest of the country how the North lacks its variety. In addition to the one-act plays he wrote for the thespians, George Beaumont wrote plays specifically designed for radio, and F.A. Bean, who you may remember was a railway's clerk, had two of his plays broadcast by the BBC, one in 1933, which featured a train robbery, as well as describing life in a railway goods office, and in 1937, Lost in Transit, a farce about a non-existent giraffe. Following their broadcasting debut in 1926, the Huddersfield Thespians once again performed under their own name in October 1929 in the one-act play Neighbouring Love. Described as a West Riding comedy, it was written by F.A. Carter, who also produced the play for radio. At least 11 further plays written by Freddie Carter were transmitted on the radio between 1930 and 1936, but these were all performed by his Yorkshire Radio Comedy Players, which again featured thespian members and were often referred to as such in the press. And when celebrated actress Sybil Thorndike gave a lunchtime talk in Huddersfield in 1931, she paid tribute to the thespians, declaring that she had wanted to come to Huddersfield for a long time because she had known that it was the beginning of a movement that interested her more than anything else in her life, the rising from the people themselves of a new theatre in this country and a new aspect of the art which belonged to them as the English people, the art of acting. And perhaps the Stockport Garrick might have had something to say about that. Surveying the West Riding's amateur dramatic scene in 1946, novelist Phyllis Bentley declared that it all started in Huddersfield. The Huddersfield Thespian, she suggested, had to take precedence over the other societies on the grounds of seniority, having been founded in 1920, adding that the pioneering work of this society gave the West Riding an admirable lead towards a far higher standard of acting and production than the word amateur used to connote. She remembered the strange cerebral beauty of the adding machine, even though it called wrath down upon the thespians from some religious quarters, and noted the attention they had given to dialect plays. Set design and construction had always played an important part in the thespians' work, and Bentley praised the especial attention given to the staging and scening aspects of theatre. But as president of the Halifax Thespians, she was also keen to point out that their Green Room Club had 406 members and has also recently purchased a disused chapel to convert into a playhouse. I suspect that Gregson may have been disappointed by the Thespians' failure to acquire their own performance space. In December 1926, the Carnegie Trust announced they were prepared to give the Society £1,000 for the erection of a new building or the adaptation of an existing building, but on condition that they would have to acquire the rest of the funding from other sources. The Trust would have to approve the plans, and building work had to begin within the year. At this point, the Society only had £100 in its building fund, no suitable site had yet been found, and it was thought that £3,000 to £4,000 would be required. By the end of the following year, it looked as though a new building might be the best option, as Huddersfield Corporation has expressed a willingness to rent them a vacant site, either on Cambridge Road or Towning Road, now under the Ring Road. But 2 years later, Gregson could comment, "The Huddersfield Thespians, in spite of the offer of help from the Carnegie Trust Fund, still functions in the depressing Temperance Hall with the most uncomfortable seating ever devised for the torture of enthusiasts." It may be that not all of the Society's members saw the urgency to acquire a theatre space of their own. In the early years, they had used the Theatre Royal for some of their performances. In his Jubilee history, Sidney Crowther suggested that some members felt that the tendency was towards two classes of casts, with only some players being seen as suitable for the Theatre Royal. In any case, the possibility of using the theatre came to an end with Waring's resignation in August 1931. This was the year that the Thespians moved to the Co-op's Victoria Hall, the Society contributing £500 to convert the hall into a theatre. But in 1938, the Co-op's planned extension meant that the Victoria Hall would have to go. So they had to move again, this time to St Patrick's Hall, where they stayed until the 1960s. The hall had to be demolished to make way for the Ring Road. When the Little Theatre Guild of Great Britain was formed in 1946, the Huddersfield Thespians were ineligible for membership because they did not own or lease a building on which to stage their own productions. Now, I focused here on places for performances, but amateur theatre groups also needed spaces that could be used for set building and storage, not to mention somewhere to meet and rehearse, and later on to keep their expanding wardrobe. Having made several moves, they found they could combine these functions when they were able to rent two floors at Oaks Mills West, staying there for 48 years. In 1928, Gregson had used his Leeds Mercury column to suggest that the best way to mark the Diamond Jubilee of Huddersfield's incorporation would be to build a municipal theatre, an opera house. And writing in the Examiner in 1969, Thespian President Philip Hillaby suggested the societies should come together to work towards a theatre for the town. The Thespian search for a building continued after World War II, and it came to an end with the formation of the Kirtley's Theatre Trust and the opening of the Lawrence Batley Theatre. The Thespian's production of J.B. Priestley's When We Are Married was the first play to be performed there in September 1994. However, some long-standing Thespians still feel that their pre-war antecedents, given their connections, could have done a lot more to establish their own playhouse. When the Second World War came, with many thespians in the forces, plays had to be chosen for smaller casts. In October 1940, Gregson came to the rescue, or so it was presented in the press, by staging a revival of his play, The Marstons, which he both produced and acted in. Gregson went off to work for the BBC in London, but the thespians carried on, producing plays throughout the war. When in 1943, an article in the stage newspaper entitled They Also Serve paid tribute to the role amateur companies were playing in the war, the Huddersfield Thespians were amongst the nine to receive special mention. Gregson returned to Yorkshire after the war as the BBC's North Regional Sound Drama Director, a role especially created for him. Interestingly, he told the press that his curtain raiser play would introduce a small company of actors recruited from amateur dramatic societies, and it's clear that he was happy to have thespians act in his radio plays. Gregson had hoped for a society that would be experimental, but the thespians were above all a society for the town. Perhaps their production record was best summed up by Secretary George Rushworth in 1936, in answer to an anonymous theatre-goer who heard complain that their plays were more often than not sordid and morbid. Rushworth said, "Anyone who cares to look at the programme of plays we have produced during the past 16 years will find that 60% of them have been of the light type, having definite entertainment value. It is not our aim to stage popular plays that one may see in any commercial theatre. We perform unusual plays, which commercial theatres rightly reject." 100 years on, the Thespians are still a little theatre without a theatre, but they are still here, and having recently moved to new headquarters, are looking forward to the day when my performances are again possible and they can continue to play their part in the cultural life of our town. Thank you.
This talk has been one of Huddersfield Local History Society's 2020-2021 programme. We are a membership society and it would be very good if you could come and join us. But if you can't do that, given these difficult COVID times, you can visit our website. There you'll be able to find out what we do, who we are, and what sort of events and publications we have. Thank you for coming and listening to the talk. We hope to see you again next time. Goodbye for now.